cosmology, but it's not at all.
Okay. In fact, I wanted to change. There is one. Which one?
This one.
Okay. Okay. First of all, as you see that I slightly changed the title, or maybe completely. Instead of cosmology, which is very general title, and in this sense it's completely not informative, my subject will be cosmic anti-gravity. And there are two reasons maybe for that. First of all, discovery of cosmic or cosmological anti-gravity made, I think, by accumulated data during last quarter century was probably one of the most striking discoveries in cosmology and maybe in physics, in fundamental physics. And second, I was slightly cheating, because if I want to talk about cosmic anti-gravity, I need to talk essentially about all cosmology. But of course it's impossible, but I at least try to present some picture. So what was discovered? That the universe is expanded with acceleration. Let me see if it works. So I describe, this is the content of my three lectures. So I will talk a little bit about the picture related to cosmic. It's here, it works. I don't trust it. So, describe the picture, and then briefly derive basic cosmological equations in a very naive and slightly cheating way. And then I describe what we know about the universe today, cosmological parameters, how we measure something which we cannot see. And then I will talk about maybe most striking theoretical problem related to this subject, namely the problem of vacuum energy. It also is closely related to universe acceleration. And the phenomenological description of this acceleration, whether we have some unknown object, some unknown agent called dark energy, or maybe modification of gravity at very big scales. By very big, I mean not least, but the scales comparable to the size of our universe. So I will start with a very simple, I would say, trivial example, how we can imagine a universe expansion. It is very similar to what we have in our everyday life. If we have a stone and throw it up, just here, we see how it will go up. It will go with decreasing velocity, then at some moment it stops, and it will come back once I throw a snowball, and so perfectly. And so it hit me here, and it was quite painful. So it made me come back to very similar hot state. At least it was believed previously. Another possibility, if you throw a stone with very big velocity, so it never will come back, so-called first or second cosmic velocity, throw it vertically, and so if velocity was big enough, we will have the motion of the stone again with decreasing velocity. And in this case there are one particular very special case that if initial velocity was so well fine-tuned that at infinity final velocity of the stone, it will go to infinity, but final velocity would be zero. And this particular case is exactly what is realized in cosmology. So it's very strong fine-tuning of the conditions in cosmology. So it was believed that cosmological expansion is exactly like that, that universe expands with decreasing velocity, with, what is this, depending upon the sign, with normal negative acceleration, and depending upon geometry of the universe, if it is open or closed, the situation would be the following. For closed universe, expansion would last for some time, and then the universe would recollapse, and we will, it would be a rather sad story, that we come to get some hot and very dense state and block. Nothing would help us in this case. Another possibility, if initial conditions were such that geometry substance was open, in this case universe would expand forever. And the intermediate state corresponds to geometrically flat, three-dimensionally flat universe, like normal Euclidean geometry which we all studied in school. And in that case, it would also expand forever, and velocity at infinity would be zero. And observation shows that exactly this case is realized in cosmology. So, as I said, it was believed to be true in cosmological case, and it was assumed that acceleration was negative. Okay, now, so I already said about that. So how it all described in general relativity, the basis of cosmology is Einstein theory, and we assume that because of existence of gravitational matter, space-time is curved, it is not flat, and this is very well known even for people who didn't study general relativity. And we have main quantity with which we work to describe effects of general relativity and in particular cosmology is interval. You know that in the case of Minkowski space interval is just dt squared minus dr squared. So it's Minkowski's space-time, which is flat. In case of in cosmological situation, space-time is curved, and the metric is also very simple. It is homogeneous and isotropic because of observation, because it was assumption made by Friedman, but we know that it is the case because indeed distribution of matter, at least at large scales, is homogeneous and isotropic. And this is form of metric, and I would like to direct your attention to this factor a squared of t, which describes universe expansion at the so-called scale factor. Distance between two objects which do not interact with each other increases or behaves like this quantity a of t. And of course, if you have gravitationally bound system like galaxy, or not to say about hydrogen atoms, their size is not changed during universe expansion. It is like motion by inertia. There was some initial push after the universe started to expand. Okay, and this function f of r corresponds to three-dimensional curvature, and if it is given by this expression, and if k is equal to zero, we have normal flat geometry. It is normal metric in three-dimensional flat space. And if k is not zero, it is, I think, positive k corresponds to closed universe, negative k corresponds to open universe. So the evolution is governed by these equations, and I'm not exact famous Einstein equations, and I'm not going to decipher what is that. It is some curvature tensor, it is curvature scalar. Important thing is right-hand side, this H, it is energy momentum tensor of matter, which is obtained by the usual rules as functional derivative of action with respect to matter. And because theory is invariant with respect to change, choice of coordinate system, according to Noether theorem, this quantity is conserved. This is important. And now I'm going to derive, in principle, one can derive five basic cosmological equations, substituting expression for metric, which was two slides before, into Einstein equation, and after maybe writing three, four pages of accurate calculations, you find these very simple equations. There is some trick which allows to derive these equations, and if I forget coefficients, I use this trick to derive explicitly correct equation. Namely, let us assume that there is homogeneous distribution of matter, and take some spherical part of this homogeneous distribution and study motion of test body on the boundary of this sphere. So there is one standard non-relativistic Newtonian mechanics. At some stage, it's slightly cheating, and you, but maybe some of you will catch me when I'm cheating. So we have velocity squared, kinetic energy is equal to potential energy, which is mass divided by radius, and plus constant. It is the law of conservation of total energy. Kinetic energy plus potential energy is constant. So it is what is written here, A dot over A squared is kinetic energy, its velocity, and this is denoted as Hubble parameter squared, equal to mass inside the sphere divided by radius of the sphere, and it is a Newtonian coupling constant, it is here, and rho is energy density inside the sphere, and equal to a constant. I divided everything by A squared, so K is a constant, and divided by A squared, and mass is equal to the integral of. So this is first equation, it is first Friedman equation, which is one of the basic equations of cosmology, and we derived it in such a way. So it looks really kind of tricky. Another equation is balance of energy. We have energy inside certain small volume, and energy is equal to rho, energy density, multiplied by volume, and correspondingly dV, degree of shape is dV. And P is pressure density. So if we do accurate differentiation, we find the following very beautiful equation. Rho dot is equal to, I would say better maybe to write, minus 3H P plus rho. It's again a fundamental equation. And using these equations, we can describe all the universe evolution when the universe was homogeneous and isotropic. Not exactly again, but I will correct myself later. And from these two equations, we can derive equation by differentiating Hubble parameter. We find expression for acceleration. Acceleration is equal to minus negative sine of rho plus 3p. Please pay attention to this mechanism. Rho plus 3p. So first thing is here that you notice that usually acceleration is proportional to particle, to mass of the attracting body, and now we see that also pressure gravitates. And in what stage I make some some deception. You see, normally if you have Newtonian theory, pressure never enters into consideration. And it will be really disaster because we only exist only because pressure gravitates and pressure may be negative and it could create universe expansion. Otherwise our world together with this school would never exist. And so this is the question. And the answer is that in Newtonian theory, gravitating agent, source of gravity, is mass, not energy density. And I took energy density and assumed conservation of energy. And because of that, pressure came into consideration. And the equation which I showed you before, this one, is simply covariant law of conservation of energy momentum tensor in this particular context. Okay, so now what I wanted to say, another thing, that if pressure is negative and small and by absolute value bigger than energy density divided by 3, you see that expansion would have overall positive sign, so universe would expand with increasing velocity. And it is a kind of anti-gravity. If you have normal Newtonian theory, then you get always minus sign here. The storm would go with decreasing velocity up there. Okay. Next question, of course, one can ask that using these arguments, clever engineer to construct some spaceship, space missiles, based on anti-gravitation, if they somehow manage to create negative pressure. The answer is absolutely not. If we have positive definite energy density, then this is necessary. Otherwise, theory would be, not only theory would be pathological, but also whole world would be pathological. And one can show that for anti-gravity could exist only for infinitely large systems, for which, it will be clear on the next page, Gauss theorem is not applicable. If we have finite distribution of mass, of energy, then we can integrate by parts certain expression, and in that case we'll see that what gravitates is only energy density. Pressure doesn't come into consideration, but for infinitely large system it is not true. And there are examples like whole universe, membrane walls, which could be produced when discrete symmetry is spontaneously broken, or cosmic strings, which also created in the case of spontaneous broken U1 symmetry, all these objects can create gravitational repulsion in a sense. But any finite object is always gravitationally attractive. And hint how to prove it. First of all, you can study some very well-known Schwarzschild solution, namely gravitational field of spherically symmetric mass distribution, and you can see that the source of gravity, at least asymptotically, is simply mass, which is integral of energy density. It is not exactly energy density before zero, because we have zero here and zero up here. It is, and energy density is T00 both below, both up, downstairs. So metric comes here, and it simply describes gravitational mass defect. You can see it in Landau Lipschitz or somewhere where Schwarzschild solution is described. So just independently of or on equation of state, always we have energy density which comes here, and if energy density is positive and coefficient G, metric coefficient G00, it must be positive. So coefficient in front of time always must be positive. So we have mass always positive and always gravity independent from the pressure. You can do that more formally, and I showed how the principle can be done. The source of gravity is integral over volume of energy momentum tensor. So I took space-space component, and it can be easily proven that it is zero if I can integrate by part. So I took, this is usual trick, derivative of product of energy momentum tensor, space-space component multiplied by coordinate. And keeping in mind that we study stationary field, so derivative of T, Jk is zero, and we can do that, that source of gravity integrated over volume is zero if we study space-space component. So pressure doesn't gravitate for any objects for which we can use Gauss law. Okay, so summary, we have three equations. One is for acceleration, or expression for the Hubble parameter. Sorry, for velocity, it is expression for Hubble parameter. Another for acceleration. And the last one is evolution of energy density. And one can check that there are no stationary solutions. And at the last, my last lecture, I will talk about deep disappointment by Albert Einstein, who found that his equations doesn't allow stationary solution. And he was really made very interesting generalization, then introduced cosmological constant for vacuum energy, but it was like opening Pandora box, as it was understood later. So, rather, I think, also interesting thing. So, as I already said, that only two out of these three equations are independent, because equation for acceleration can be obtained by differentiating equation for Hubble parameter. It is one thing, and then I already stressed it, that source of gravity in cosmology is rho plus Rt, and I already said that also equation for evolution of energy density is covariant conservation of energy momentum tensor, and the mu is covariant derivative in curved space-time. So even in normal, those who doesn't know general relativity still shouldn't be afraid of covariant derivative. If we have flat space-time, normal Euclidean space-time, and take, for example, a spherical coordinate, then derivatives in spherical coordinate is not just d over dr or d over d phi. Then you have to introduce some kind of connection, which is related to the fact that coordinate lines are curved. But if not only coordinate lines are curved, but also the space-time is curved, we have to somehow to generalize this derivative. And energy momentum tensor is conserved in this tensor form. Okay, I already said. Now I have to introduce some parameters to be better understood what we are going to talk. First of all, the definition is redshift, cosmological redshift. It is the ratio of the scale factor today to the sun scale factor in some normally earlier stage. So it's how much universe expanded. And we say that, for example, at redshift equal to 1,000, I will talk about it later, when the universe was 1,000 times smaller, it could be infinitely large, but it was one, or linear sizes was 1,000 times smaller. In that case, it responds to z equal to 1,000. So it is present day value of the scale factor, and this is value of the scale factor at recombination of hydrogen. So we can, if you have less space time, we can derive very important equation, which is more or less trivial, how momentum of any particle behaves in expanding universe. We simply take two bodies separated by distance dx and take into account, well, make Lorentz transformation from one body to another and take into account Doppler effect of momentum. And after that, it's more or less simple algebra. We find that momentum of any particles drop down as minus hp. It means that momentum of any particles, you can make any particle, you can easily integrate this equation, drops down as universe size, as inverse scale factor. I also mean that. So it's written here that v is equal to 1 over a or 1 over z plus 1. And this is more accurate if you need to do some more serious calculations and they can recover curvature term, but it is mostly unknown. And this is system of units, probably you are familiar with that, but just for information, that's natural system of units, that speed of light, Planck constant over 2 pi, and Boltzmann constant is equal to 1. Astronomers quite often are very much against this system of units, but I think they were first person who introduced beginning of the system of units, because they are first people to measure distance in time. They say distance to the nearest star is 4 years. So they assume that exactly that. So 1 centimeter is equal to 10 to minus 3 times 10 to minus 11 seconds. It's all needed. It's very convenient. So there are basic cosmological parameters. One was already introduced, namely Hubble parameter. It describes the rate of universe expansion, a dot over a. It means that objects which are not gravitationally bound to us, far away galaxies, runs away from us proportional to the Hubble parameter multiplied by the distance. It's very well known Hubble law, although it was probably found earlier by Lemaître or some other people, but it's already impossible to recover historical justice. Then another thing which is very important is parameter omega is ratio of a certain form of energy density with respect to so-called critical energy density. Critical energy density is Hubble parameter squared, mass Planck squared, and some numerical coefficient. Critical energy density would be real physical energy density if k, if you remember, parameter which enters for expression for Hubble, it would be equal to zero. It corresponds to spatially flat Euclidean universe. So, and this omega, all what we see in the sky, all forms of matter, their abundance, this is expressed through this parameter omega. Okay. So, as I said, there are 2 equations and 3 unknowns, and we need to introduce 1 more equation, and this is not just hypothesis, it is physics. So we have to describe what kind of matter we have. And this is so-called equation of state. A pressure is equal to a function, some function of energy density. It mostly state of matter in cosmological situation can be described by this equation, but not only so. It could be, for example, some cases and pressure is not a simple a function, a local function. It could be some integral or something. For example, if we have a scalar field, and this may be important for when I will talk about dark energy, so-called quintessence and things like that, which satisfies this equation, and for that we cannot express pressure locally through energy density. But there is no problem because we have equation of state and we can always express everything is determined dynamically and there are no ambiguity at all. So I recommend you to calculate, take scalar field, free scalar field with mass squared phi squared Lagrangian, and calculate pressure and energy density for this field and see what will be effective equation of state. And now simple examples, which are probably known for even for beginners who studied cosmology. If we have non-relativistic matter, for non-relativistic matter, energy density is mc squared, or c equal 1 is just mass, And pressure density is m by v, and velocity is supposed to be much smaller than the speed of light, so pressure is negligibly small. You take the pressure equal to zero, and rho dot is equal to minus 3 h rho. If you remember what you have here, we would have here in bracket p plus rho plus p. So rho dot is equal to that. You can easily integrate this equation and find that energy density drops like 1 over a cube. And it's also clear, if we have space expanding with filled with stones and they run away from each other, number of stones drops down in certain volume, like volume, and so it is dilution of energy density of massive particles which are at rest in their own frame. So they move with respect to each other, but they don't move with respect to observer which sits with them and look at them. There is cosmological relevance, but not in the excess. And we can easily know that A over A is Hubble parameter squared is equal to rho. In this case, Hubble is equal to square root of rho. We can find expansion regime which is time to power 2 terms. Another thing that we have relativistic matter. From second volume of Landau-Lifshitz, we know that for relativistic matter, pressure density is equal to rho divided by 3, and we see that rho dot is equal to minus 4 h rho. It means that energy density drops down like scale factor to power 4. It's also clear, number of photons in volume drops down like a cube, but energy of each volume drops down like a, as I showed in that p dot is equal to minus hp. So it is just redshift of energy density of photons. If you have gas in some box and start to move box walls, well, to inflate this box, then velocity would drop according to this law, and so we have this simple.
This is relativistic or non-relativistic?
It is relativistic.
The NR is a misprint.
Where?
In last line.
Yeah. It should be very relativistic. We are. Okay, thank you. I copied from another place.
Yes,
but it is. Thank you. Okay. So, and there is very important and very unusual and counterintuitive regime, so called vacuum or vacuum like energy. When energy momentum tensor is proportional to metric tensor. And nobody told you that vacuum should have zero energy. It is a state with lowest energy density. And according to simple estimates, which we'll talk after tomorrow, there are plenty of contribution into vacuum energy, and there is constant headache to somehow get rid of it. So, and this is the only possible form of vacuum energy, because vacuum is something which looks the same in any coordinate frame, and the only symmetric invariant tensor is metric tensor. So it should be proportional to metric tensor. In this case, vacuum pressure of vacuum is equal to minus energy density of vacuum. If we substitute it in the equation of motion, we will see that rho dot is zero, so vacuum energy remains constant in the course of universe expansion. There are plenty of solutions of suggestion to solve the problem of vacuum energy, assuming that it changes with time. And this is very completely not innocent assumption because of this equation. People did something and some of papers are reasonable, but mostly no. So in this case, we would have that universe expands exponentially and Hubble parameter is really Hubble constant. Hubble constant was told, it is old term, and it was named like that because it was supposed, and this is true, that Hubble parameter is constant over all space. But it changes the function of time because Hubble is roughly speaking universal.
Can you say again why P back is minus rho?
You see metric tensor, it's, let's take a simple example, Minkowski's first time. Tensor is 1, minus 1, minus 1, minus 1. And because of that, space coordinates, space components are minus time component, and this is my pressure is equal to minus 1. Okay, you can do that, define it for curved space time, and then you should remember to lift up indices of energy momentum tensor, but you come to the same conclusion even in curved space time. So, to describe more general way, linear equation of state, a new cosmological parameter, W was introduced, and this is quite popular parameter now, that pressure is equal to W by rho. And in particular, it was measured that for this mysterious substance, vacuum energy W is very close to minus 1. So what induces cosmic acceleration may be vacuum energy. But again, day after tomorrow, we'll return to that. So I recommend you to find expansion region for arbitrary W, and in particular to see what happens if W would be smaller than minus 1. And I tell you that you will be rather surprised. You see, it's very unusual. So what we know about universe today? We know that universe expands, and the rate of expansion is given by parameter H, capital. Here I should probably put H sub zero. It is usual notation, meaning that it is value of Hubble parameter today. It behaves, roughly speaking, as inverse universe H. It is equal to 100 kilometers per second per megaparsec, so it means that object at a distance of 3 million light years from us run away from with velocity 100 multiplied by this small h. And during the last maybe 20 years ago, there was no disagreement. There were two values for this small h, two groups were. One said that h small was equal to 0.5. The other used to say that h small was equal to 1. And surprisingly, the equilibrium was found just in the middle. H is roughly speaking 0.73. It is written here, 0.73. And inverse Hubble parameter here is roughly speaking 13.4 billion years. It is more or less age of our universe, but not exactly. And this is important for at least first hint that something is wrong with the universe expansion. It was called 15, 20 years ago as the universe age crisis. It is, if we estimated universe age according to the standard cosmology, it would be much smaller than measured. What does it mean measured? There are two ways to estimate universe age. One is from the age of all stellar globular clusters. In this case, we observe something, some objects, and knowing the theory of stellar evolution, we can calculate how long it was necessary to come to this beautiful state. So it's almost dead clusters, and using that we can estimate universe age in these limits. Another thing is to find, to measure, it's not so difficult, ratio of radioactive elements with big lifetime, like uranium 235 and uranium 238. They have a lifetime of roughly speaking 5 billion years, somewhat different. And knowing what we observe now, the ratio, and assuming that we have correct theory which explains their formation. Formation of these heavy elements is always the same. They were formed in supernova, at explosion of the supernova, and they were dispersed in the state. All light elements were formed in the very early universe. Everything after helium was formed in stellar evolution and explosion. So all we are dust from a supernova explosion. Somehow sun came to this cloud or whatever. So both methods gives more or less the same result. Okay, we can calculate universe age. We take an expression for Hubble parameter, and A dot, I rewrote this equation, and we can integrate it and find the expression for the universe age, which is quite interesting. The inverse value of Hubble parameter at the present time with certain integral which contains square root 1 minus total energy density of the universe. Relative, it is omega total, and normally it is very close to 1. Then energy density of normal, relative, non-relativistic matter, and energy density of relativistic matter, and energy density of vacuum. And conditioned function variable x comes because of different law of evolution of this thing. Vacuum energy stays constant, relativistic is brought down at last scale factor to power 4, and non-relativistic matter is scale field. And if we take, for example, total energy equal to energy of massive matter and take it measured value 0.3, universe will be much longer than measured. And if we take total energy density equal to 1, omega matter equal to 0.3 and omega vacuum 0.7, beautiful agreement. We can easily see why an adding of vacuum energy increases universe age. What we know some law of scale factor evolution. And we know derivative. This one. It is h. H which is a dot divided by a. So it's here. So that could be the following evolution. Normal evolution with deceleration or evolution with acceleration. So if we have anti-gravitating regime, lifetime could be considerably larger. Of course, you can see it from integration of this equation, but I simply wanted to illustrate why fast cosmological expansion leads to longer universe age. One should expect something opposite, but it's this way. So a very important thing is critical energy density and knowing value of the Hubble. I thought having a friend as a chairman would help.
Okay.
So critical energy density is a very important thing. It is about 10 to the power 29 grams per cubic centimeter. Remember that h squared is 0.5, and it is good to express it in kilo electron volts per cubic centimeter, or just in natural units, giga electron volt to power 4, 10 to the power minus 47. Please remember this number till at least till Saturday. Okay, so important, this number corresponds to 10 protons per cubic meter, but in fact, protons, roughly speaking, 20 times less. So we have
20 orders of
20 times. So it's 1/2 a proton per cubic meter. Since we cannot cut proton, it's within 2 cubic meters. So what we have about different kind of matter? It was measured that total energy density, there are not only universe H, but two possible ways of measuring it, and especially with this cosmic microwave background radiation, very striking, very impressive result, the total energy density is close to 1. And then so geometry is Euclidean, and what is interesting is that inflationary theory predicts that this quantity should be equal to 1 with precision approximately 10 to minus 4. So it is rather beautiful prediction of inflation, which is good. And it is found from the position of the first peak in endward rotation of CMB. I show this picture later. And this it is cosmic microwave background radiation. And this large scale structure, analysis of formation, and what is observed in the sky of that large scale structure. Usual baryonic matter, which we have all of us are made, is approximately what is this 1/20 of the total amount of energy in the universe. And it is measured by two completely independent ways. One from the analysis of cosmic microwave radiation, which is based on physics when the universe was quite old, about 100,000 years. And from deep bench nucleosynthesis, which was found from physics when the universe was approximately 1 or maybe 200-300 second old. So from and physics is completely different, but results are more or less the same. There is some unknown but normal matter, so-called dark matter. It could be elementary particles, either light or heavy, and I think it was described yesterday, as I was told, unfortunately I couldn't come yesterday when we arrived. But it could be also, for example, some unknown objects, for example, primordial black holes or something like that. In this case, detectors could be useless, but it's also an interesting possibility. And so it's about 20%, 22% of the total mass of the universe. And there is some, if you have omega equal to 1, and then we have 25% together baryons and dark matter, we would have The rest is approximately 75% of something unknown. And this is not only just simple subtraction. It is also some physics that shows that there is something in the universe which creates, which pushes universe apart with non-zero acceleration, with positive acceleration. So they are not as trivial as say we know the total energy density is 1, and what we see is 20.25, so there is 75% of something. But this 75%, not just unknown something, but it is anti-gravitating something.
And that's why you said omega is roughly minus 1.
Not omega, it is double u.
Double.
And this is not omega. No. Ah, I say yes. And this is because of measurements. They studied different pieces of data, but it is a measurement of omega, approximately minus 1. And this is not very accurate. This would be roughly speaking plus or minus 1. Plus or minus 0.1. And if it is smaller than minus 1, for those who will solve this equation, you'll tell us tomorrow what kind of cosmology we have. Okay, good. I have 7 minutes. So, except for non-relativistic matter, which we know, one is baryons, and the other are very well known dark matter, many possibilities for that. There are some relativistic matter, namely photons from microwave background radiation, and in some sense neutrino, cosmic neutrino background, CNB. Of course, neutrino now may be non-relativistic if the mass is bigger than the temperature. Neutrino temperature, we can speak about neutrino temperature if they are exactly massless. If they are not massless, they don't have equilibrium distribution, but there are some parameters similar to temperature. It's about 2 kilo electron, 2 Kelvin. So if mass is smaller than this 2 Kelvin, then neutrinos are non-relativistic now. But they were relativistic during most of the interesting part of the universe evolution. We have equilibrium spectrum, and here I presented equilibrium Bose-Einstein spectrum for photons. And there are one interesting thing, that chemical potential here, I should write, for example, omega minus mu, where mu divided by temperature, where mu is chemical potential. And it is equal to zero with the precision of 10 to minus 4 of the temperature. And this very important fact, it means that photons were in perfect thermal equilibrium before they decoupled from matter. So it's a real indication that the universe was hot. For example, this spectrum has zero chemical potential. Temperature is, you see how well it is measured, with the precision of 10 to minus 3 Kelvin. Number of photons corresponding to this distribution is about 400 photons per cubic centimeter, but not in this room. In this room is much larger number of photons. Temperature is 20 degrees, it means what? 200, something like about 300 Kelvin, and number density is proportional to temperature. So it's much more. Energy density of photons is such that omega, parameter omega, is a few, 5 times 10 to minus 5. So they play not important role in the universe evolution, but their physics is very interesting, and they help us very much to have precise measurement of cosmological parameters. In fact, when properties of angular distribution of these photons were studied, cosmology became much more precise. So it's very important. As I said, the distribution over sky of those photons is almost isotropic. This precision is better than 10 to minus 4, but there are some small fluctuations over sky. The intensity, distribution of intensity changes, in fact, I would say correlation function changes as a function of error. And fortunately, photon background is not uniform, it's not isotropic. If it would be exactly isotropic, structure formation would never be formed. It's another way around, in fact. If universe would be completely smooth, no fluctuations of energy density, then it's impossible to make any large-scale structure. Because how structures are formed. There is some excess of mass density and there is some deficit, and it is what is, it is like capitalistic situation, that those who are rich attract more and more matter and become richer and richer. In this sense, I mentioned also neutrinos. Neutrinos behave in a very communistic way, so if there is some excess of neutrinos, they run away and make universe homogeneous. In this sense, neutrino impact on structure formation is opposite to structure formation in terms of massive particles. So that, that's why some bounds of neutrino processes can be obtained. So, as I already said, that study of angular distribution of photons helps to measure cosmological parameters with very, very good precision. But there are some other ways in addition to cosmic microwave background, and they are in agreement. In fact, that like mostly, for example, study of large-scale structure formation allows to measure, for example, fluctuations of energy density at relatively small wavelengths, at the scales of order of 10 megaparsecs and smaller. While study of photons, it is bigger than 10 megaparsecs, 100 megaparsecs, and also down to megaparsecs. And then you we have theory and put two curves, and it is like, you know, making tunnel through the mountain, and sometimes they don't hit each other, and it's a disaster, but there was no such disaster for the theory, because both curves nicely hit each other. So two completely different physical situations happen to be, because coming from the same source in some sense. There are many other things, like study of vegetation lensing, cluster evolution, and recently study of so-called variable acoustic oscillations, which also it is distribution of variables related to fluctuations of photons over microwave sky environments. And also, not last, Big Bang nuclear synthesis and universe age. All these phenomena are completely different, completely independent, completely different physics, completely different moment of time, but they all indicate to the same number. Sometimes precision may be 20-30%, but sometimes it's much better, but there is no disagreement at all. And remember, please, that physics, physical processes took place at very different times and with very different phenomena. For example, gravitation lensing has nothing to do to Big Bang nuclear synthesis and so many other things, but the results are always more or less the same. So how much time?
5 minutes. 5 minutes.
Oh, okay. What?
Apologies. What are the proofs?
Come on. Okay. So, next question of how we can see it visible. It is called, by the way, dark matter, maybe 20, 25 years ago, quite often were called in the papers like invisible matter. And I think it is a better word, because dark means something which...
Doesn't shine.
Not shine, and also light is captured by this matter. So it's like, for example, if you have hydrogen, and there is some, at some frequency, light is absent, it means that it is absorbed. Yeah, forgotten. Okay, so as for dark matter, if it is, and this is I think most natural situation, if there are new stable elementary particles, there is a whole good chance, if Dama Libra get discovered it, we hope on you, that it would be directly observed in direct experiment, and it would be very important. But if not, situation would be even more interesting. And we have now many candidates. I remember there was a conference in Rencontre de Marion, and there was talk on dark matter. It was, I think, 1990 by Peebles, the famous cosmologist, and he made a review on dark matter and said that we have now about a dozen of candidates of possible dark matter particles. What do you think will be the next century beginning? Some people say 50, some people say 5. I was the only stupid person who said 1. And he said, you think that it will be discovered today? He was over-optimistic, and we see now that nothing much changed. We have even more, a little more. People are clever, and we need more and more candidates of them. But it would be impossible, as far as I understand, at least in normal theory, to observe dark energy directly. It's only cosmological, some cosmological thing. One can invent very unusual models of dark energy, which may have interaction with dark matter, but it is, you know, as Zinovich used to say, I hate papers which use square of hypothesis. The person assumes something not very probable, and inside this framework to make another very probable assumption. So, as for dark energy, I think this is at least square of human hypothesis. I would present some simple qualitative arguments in favor of dark matter. Namely, if we don't have dark matter, if we have only baryons, structure formation could start only after hydrogen recombination. Because before hydrogen recombination, plasma consisted of protons and electrons. And the electrons were practically frozen inside bath of microwave photons. Thomson cross-section is alpha squared over mass squared, 8 pi over 3, I think, doesn't matter, so it's very big, so electrons cannot move in this bath of protons which cannot form structures because they are very relativistic. And only after hydrogen was formed and plasma became neutral, only after that structure formation can start. And one can calculate that recombination took place at redshift equal to 1000, when temperature was, roughly speaking, it is now 3 Kelvin, and then 1000 it was 0.1 electron volts. It's also an interesting thing that hydrogen binding energy is something like 14.6 or 13.6. Okay, that's about 15 electron volts, and the recombination started at 0.1 electron volt, 150 times less than hydrogen binding energy. And this is because we have about how many billion or several billion photons per one atom, per electron and proton. And photons on the tail of this distribution would have enough energy to destroy hydrogen atoms. So we have to cool down plasma much below binding energy. So this was recombination redshift 10 to the power 3. And at this stage, density, we assume that there are some small density fluctuations which could rise when particles would start to clump, making structures. And clumping could start only at redshift equal to 1000. And it can be shown that structures rises, it's a kind of hydrodynamic equations together with gravity. It's more or less classical physics. And hydrodynamics is known to everybody, not a little bit complicated because of nonlinearity. So density contrast could rise as redshift. So delta rho over rho can rise only by 1000. On the other hand, we know by measurement of fluctuations of the temperature of microwave radiation that they are smaller than 10 to minus 5. So what happens? In fact, delta rho over rho is not exactly 1 minute equal to delta T over T within a factor of 3 or something like that. So anyhow, delta rho over rho could not rise from this number more than by 1000. So today we wouldn't have structures with delta rho over rho equal to 1 or even much more. After delta rho became equal to unity, delta rho over rho, then there is a kind of very fast structure formation takes place. So in this case, if we have only baryons, it's impossible to make structures now. So I say, and with dark matter is neutral, so structure formation can start considerably earlier at redshift of order of 10,000, and it's already okay. That's all.
This time for questions before dinner. Yes?
You draw that graph of evolution of universe, and we have two ages of universe, shorter and longer one. but where on that graph should be age calculated from the old star clusters?
You see, these are, I put two values, 12 and 15 billion years. It is more or less data obtained by both methods. And this is 3 billion years is precision of these calculations. We don't know very well formation of, for example, heavy elements, uranium or radium osmium, which I didn't mention. And there is some inaccuracy in calculations, or better to say, calculations can be done very precisely, but of our knowledge, how things evolve. So it's, and the results are more or less the same for by two methods. It is, let's say, 13.5 plus minus 1.5. By both methods are the same.
Which is within the limits of this 0.7,
0.12, 0.2. No, but wait. As for cosmological parameters, they are measured now very well. And theoretically, we know universe age, I would say 13.73 billion years, or something like that. I don't remember exact number, but it's something like that. So